My name is Claes Andrén. I am a biologist focusing on conservation. The plants and animals we encounter today have withstood many difficulties. They are the winners of a ruthless competition. Only the fittest have remained. They are equipped with the best possible features based on the conditions in which they live. In many cases, they have developed amazing adaptations to survive in harsh environments, to escape enemies, to become skilled hunters, to save their resources. Could it be that some of these species possess knowledge that we can benefit from? Nature's own inventions that can help us develop new materials, key technologies, smart design, and pioneering medicines to influence aging and cure cancer. Could it be that there are species that can help us create a more sustainable future? These are the questions we seek answers to. All life depends on water. Life arose on Earth 4 billion years ago, in a sunlit puddle or maybe at the bottom of the sea. We don't know for sure. How chemical reactions could build molecules that became cells, which could absorb nutrition and become living complex organisms, is still one of the riddles of science. With increasing oxygen in the atmosphere, plants and animals could move onto land. The Earth has a long and violent history, with 5 major catastrophes. Collisions with meteorites and violent volcanic eruptions have led to major climate change and mass extinction of species. But the conditions have changed and life has always come back. After the first major disaster 440 million years ago, primitive plants began to settle on land and gradually developed into forests. Large insects like dragonflies dominated the air. In the sea, life had long been inhabited by invertebrates such as mussels, trilobites, and octopuses. Then came the ages of fishes and amphibians who moved onto land. A new era began when the large reptiles developed, both in the sea and on land. ~250 million years ago, the biggest catastrophe we know took place. The devastation is hard to imagine. The Earth turned into a black desert. Only a few percent of the Earth species survived. The forests, many fish, and the larger terrestrial animals died out. Before our time was a period that almost wiped out life on Earth. The major extinction of species opened the door for a new development. The big reptiles entered the scene. Dinosaurs began their long domination on Earth, lasting almost 200 million years. But everything changed 65 million years ago. A big meteorite crashed against the globe at a speed of perhaps 100,000 kilometers per hour and hit the Mexican Gulf. The devastation is hard to imagine. Gas, smoke, and ashes darkened the earth. The dinosaurs died out. Some insects, fish, amphibians, reptiles, and birds survived, as well as small mammals. Why some species survived and others not, we don't know. But we know that the mammals now increased in numbers and began their domination on Earth. Modern man has lived on Earth for perhaps 300,000 years, but it's just recently she had a significant impact on other species. In a very short period of time in the Earth's long history, man has conducted an unimaginable development, but also changed the conditions for all life on our planet. We are now facing a new extinction wave, which reminds us of past disasters, but where humans play a crucial role. A large number of Earth species are threatened and about to disappear. Does this have any significance for our own future? These are the kind of questions we should ask. I will take you on a trip to different places on Earth, to extreme environments that place great demands on the species living there. We will encounter plants and animals that developed behaviors and qualities that made it possible for them to master seemingly impossible conditions. It is among these nature's own ingenious inventions that we find solutions to many of the challenges of humanity. But, of course, this requires that the diversity of species in the world remains. Namibia in Southwest Africa. Here are the world's oldest deserts, 80 million years old, with up to 500 meter high dunes. Some areas have no rainfall at all. Species living here are all adapted to cope with desert conditions, to move over warm and loose sand, to create a comfortable indoor climate regardless of how the temperature varies outside. And some are active at night when it's colder. But many species also tolerate strong heat and long periods of drought. Life in an environment where water is a very limited resource. Here are species that can save and conserve water, even species that can create water. The Nara bush is a good example of a plant with adaptations to cope with a hot and dry climate. The plant can handle its need for water by condensing moist nectar on the spine tips into small drops, which are then utilized by the plant. The sharp spines offer some protection against grazing animals, but the Nara bush is still an important food resource for many species.
So this is not only a well-adapted plant for desert conditions. It's also important for animals and even for humans.
That is correct. It is very important for the livelihood of animals in the area, i.e. oryx, springbok, a lot of the insects, the birds, the small mammals, as well as the local Topinar people that live in the vicinity. They harvest the fruit for this. This is their livelihood.
And that's a flower?
This is correct. Yeah. This is the flower, which will eventually become the fruit.
Yeah.
And the melon gets to about that size, almost like a small football. Yes. So all photosynthesis will also take place in the stems of the plants because it has no leaves to minimize water loss in the desert here.
Yeah.
In Namibia's coastal desert, it never rains or very rarely. But above the cold sea, fog is formed, which blows over the desert sand. Beetles live here that can convert the mist to water. They stand on a ridge with the rear body pointing up in the air. A surface structure on the outer wings condenses moisture into small droplets that are conducted to the mouth. They also save excess water inside the body and become small mobile water tanks. By setting up slabs or nets with a similar surface structure as in the beetles, you can make use of the moisture in fog and night air. Such a method can provide people with drinking water not only in deserts but also in other places where clean water is scarce. A good example of how we mimic nature's own technology for the benefit of many people in different parts of the world. The Namak chameleon in the Namibian coastal sand dunes is the only desert-adapted chameleon in the world. The opposite toes and gripping tail make it a good climber. Camouflaged in the top of small bushes, the chameleon is difficult to detect for enemies. And with a clear view of the surroundings, it can watch for its prey. Chameleons can change color and patterns to match a new environment. The eyes move independently, and the chameleon can keep track of potential dangers in the environment and follow its prey, or completely focus on the prey. The beetles with their water supply allow chameleons to survive in the dry and warm desert. The wind constantly changes the dune landscape, sweeps away the traces of passing animals, creates new shapes and patterns. A challenge for day active animals in the desert is being able to stay on the hot ground, but also to move fast in the loose sand. Pyrenees adder has a superior way of moving forward by rolling like a spiral spring. It means that only half the body at a time is in contact with a hot surface. The snake springs forward, head first, and the body follows. It can also become invisible by sinking into the sand. Only the eyes placed on the top of the head stand out. With help of eyes and tongue tips, it scans the environment. Now, almost invisible, it is awaiting a passing prey. But the shovel-snouted lizard escapes. The next lizard may not have the same luck. The shovel-snouted lizard has two very functional adaptations for a life in the loose desert sand. The fringes along the toes increase the surface and provide a good grip on the sand when it runs, like snowshoes in loose snow. The lizard also has a pointed, flattened nose that reduces air resistance and allows it to quickly squeeze into loose sand and disappear, an effective way to escape an enemy. Modern energy-efficient high-speed trains have a front that splits the air and reduces the air resistance. Their design has great similarities with the head of the shovel-snouted lizard. There are still many phenomena in nature that we cannot explain. Large areas in Namibia have strange structures in the landscape. There are many theories about these circles, how they were formed and how they are maintained. But the scientific community has not been able to solve the mystery.
They are actually an unknown phenomenon called fairy circles. And a lot of scientists have done research on this phenomenon with several different theories. But there's no factual reason why these things occur in the Namib Desert.
Have you noticed that the growth, in fact, is a bit taller around the edge, and then it seems to be more graced further away?
Correct, yeah. That's one of the characteristics of the circles, is that the taller grass is on the edges, at least 2 to 3 times taller than the surrounding grass fields.
Okay. Yeah. No one can explain it.
Many tests have been done. Theories as far as old termitaria, poisonous euphorbia plants that grew here once upon a time, noxious gases that come up from underneath. But yeah, there's so many theories, but no fact.
And it's not one, they are like hundreds.
Exactly,
all over the area.
It expands right down from southern Angola, right throughout the Namib, the grass fields.
So next time we bring a team of scientists to solve this problem.
Let's do it. Let's not call it UFOs.
Perhaps the magic circles hide knowledge that we can benefit from in the future. Trees previously grew in wet areas in the dune landscape, but drought and intrusive salt have mummified them. All that is left is nature's own artwork standing out against the sky, dead since hundreds of years. we continue deeper into the desert in our search for plants and animals that developed adaptations to cope with this harsh environment. These nature's smart innovations only exist because they favored the species' own survival. Much in nature is still unknown to us. We are living in an exciting world where a lot remains to be discovered and learned. The oryx is well adapted to the desert environment. With its large and wide feet, it moves fast even in loose sand. In severe drought, the oryx can move across very large areas to find food. Its body temperature may rise to 45 degrees Celsius in the daytime. During the night, the body cools down and the oryx utilizes the higher humidity condensed into water drops on the vegetation it eats. Many animals in the desert are night active to avoid the heat in daytime. The web-footed gecko is such an example. During the day, it is buried, but comes out when darkness falls in the evening, with lower temperature and higher humidity.
So then I think we have a very interesting adaptation here. A nocturnal lizard,
yes.
And now in daytime, hiding under the sand.
So yeah, this is where they will spend the daylight hours. While it's quite warm, they're going underneath about 20 to 30 centimeters, where there's a constant of 16 degrees Celsius, which gives them that lovely temperature to sleep.
Exciting.
Through the day.
Should we see what we can find?
Try and give a go. We'll start to dig. You'll see a little tunnel crumbling there.
Oh, yeah. I can see the hole now.
You can see the hole crumbling there.
Yeah.
Let's see how deep he goes.
Oh, yeah. I see it.
That's a baby.
It's a baby one?
This is a very small
web-footed
gecko. And
what fantastic
as
eyes.
You can see the little webbed feet.
Yeah.
Like snowshoes.
Yes.
Made specifically for walking on the sand here so it doesn't sink in.
Yeah.
And there you can also see by the size of the eyes that this is a nocturnal species.
Mm.
Large eyes allowing a lot of light in so that you can see at night. And as you can see, over the eyes, they have a waxy protective layer, like a contact lens. And they will get a new one every time they change their skin every few months. And this is just to protect against scratching in the sand so that they don't scratch. They cannot blink. They have no eyelids.
Yeah.
So that's also how they sometimes gather some moisture. Early mornings, before the sun rises, micro droplets will form on the eyeballs. And they actually physically use the tongue, like a windscreen wiper, to clean that off.
The spade-shaped feet are important for moving fast in loose sand, but mainly to dig into the sand. At dawn, the desert geckos hide a few decimeters down in the sand and spend the day at a comfortable distance from the hot surface. In Namibia, there is the world's only desert-adapted elephant. They have longer legs and can move quickly over long distances. Daytime, the acacia trees offer the only protection against the sun. They also cool down by waving their ears where they have superficial blood vessels. The acacia trees have leaves desirable to many animals. But at the same time, these are protected by the long, hard, and pointed thorns. But there are those who do not seem to worry about this. The giraffe's tongue and mouth cavity are covered in a thick leather-like skin that the thorns do not pierce. But it must crush the thorns carefully before swallowing them. On the savannah, there are interesting buildings that can maintain a favorable indoor climate through their ingenious ventilation, regardless of variations in the temperature outside. It is the termites' high-rise building equipped with ventilated basement and chimneys. The termites feed on a fungus that they themselves grow underground, but the fungus requires a stable and high temperature and moisture. We meet a Swedish engineer who applied this technology in schools and offices.
Vi har kopierat termitstackens ventilationssystem dels genom luftintaget, att man då tar in luften via långa gångar i mark, men också genom deras sätt att släppa ut luften genom att ha höga torn. Och på det viset förbättrar de termiska drivkrafterna för ventilationen. Termiterna går ju upp då och reglerar flödet över dagen genom att ställa sig i de här gångarna och täppa till dem och öppna upp dem. Och vad vi istället gör, det är att ha motoriserade spjäll som öppnar och stänger på olika parametrar. Exempelvis så mäter vi rumstemperaturen i varje rum och kan då öppna spjället i just det rummet efter temperaturen.
Through the spacious air ducts in the ground we get additional heat in winter time and cooling in summertime, a seasonally adapted ventilation. The ventilation driving force is based on temperature and height differences. Therefore, tall chimneys have been built in the same way as the termites do. The environmentally friendly termite ventilation has a significantly lower operating cost and gives a healthier indoor climate. The quiver tree got its name from the indigenous South African inhabitants who used the hollow branches to store their arrows. The bark is scaly and covered with white powder. The effect is that the solar radiation is reflected and the stem is protected from the hot air. The powdered bark flakes on the trunk work as when you protect the outside of a spacecraft with heat shields to cope with the high temperature in space. Because of this adaptation, the quiver tree can survive in very hot areas. In Namibia's desert, there is also an ancient relative of the coniferous trees. Single individuals can live for 2,000 years. It is the welwitschia. It can collect and store water in a deep root, up to 8 meters in depth, like a massive carrot. A flowering male tree. The stem is short and the whole tree rarely exceeds 1 meter. Welwitschia has two large leaves that split into many ribbons. The width of an individual tree, including the leaves, can be up to 8 meters. The female tree has pine cones typical of coniferous. The welwitschia is supplied with water from humid night air when the temperature drops, but also from groundwater through the long root. During longer periods of drought, the stress of the animals increases. Many species have no alternatives. They need access to water to drink and cool themselves. More and more move towards the remaining water holes. They stay for a while to drink and cool down, and then retreat. Most of Australia is desert or savanna. It is the world's driest continent. The sand is often yellow or red from corroded ore and metals. The nutrient-poor soil and high day temperatures have led to the development of heat-resistant plants with special adaptations to minimize water loss. Geographical isolation for 50 million years has resulted in a unique plant and animal world. More than 80% of Australia's mammals, reptiles, amphibians and plants occur here and nowhere else. Heat and drought cause many fires in these areas. And the grass tree only drops its seeds after strong heating, like in a fire. The echidna digs into the ground and is thus protected against fires that sweep past. It is also protected from predators by hairy and pointed spikes covering its back and by securing itself to the ground with long bent claws. The echidna has a trunk-like nose and lives almost exclusively on termites, which it eats by sticking out its sticky tongue at high speed, up to 100 times per minute. Many snakes thrive in hot, dry areas. In Australia, an unusually high proportion of snakes are poisonous. In parks where children play and joggers pass, you can see signs like this. People and dangerous snakes have found a way of living side by side. The poisonous tiger snake feeds on frogs, birds, and smaller mammals. If you get too close, it hisses to warn you and then backs off. The snake has many small muscles underneath the skin that adhere to the body scales. With the help of these, the snake can get a good grip when moving. With its forked tongue, the snake collects scent information from its surroundings. The scent is then interpreted by the brain with the help of a special organ in the upper part of the mouth. Here in the desert of Australia, a mythical animal lives, terrifying in appearance and often depicted as the symbol of evil. Head and body are covered in long, sharp spikes. It is the thorny devil, or Moloch. It has a real and a false head. When an enemy attacks, it bends down to hide its true head and shows the false one. An injury to the false head is not as serious. The Moloch also has a jerky walk. It creates confusion in a predator who expects a different escape behavior. In fact, the Moloch is a harmless little lizard who feeds on ants. The sharp spikes certainly protect the lizard against predators, but they also have another, perhaps more important function. At night, when the temperature drops, the humidity increases, condensing into small water drops on the tips of the spikes. The water droplets flow down to the body and are sucked up in the skin like in a sponge. Then they flow into narrow channels in the skin to the mouth. The Moloch can swallow the water without opening its mouth. Through the skin ducts, the lizard can also soak up water with its feet from wet soil and lead it to the mouth. Many desert plants have spikes that protect them from grazing animals. But as in the Moloch, these plants can use the moisture in the cold night air and condense it to life-giving water drops. The ability and technology of desert plants and animals to create water by transforming fog, like the beetles and narabush in Namibia, and the night moisture, like the desert monster in Australia. This can be of great importance for people living in dry areas or in other places where clean drinking water is scarce. By combining the surface structures of these plants and animals, it has been possible to develop material that collects the water drops 10 times more efficiently than other contemporary materials. another part of the world, but in many ways similar challenges for plants and wildlife. A species lives here that has found a way to outwit an unpredictable environment. Individuals in the same population have different reproductive strategies, unusual in the animal world. Most people imagine a desert like this, only sand as far as the eye reaches. But desert-like conditions can be found in other places as well. The outer archipelago of the Swedish west coast bears great resemblance to a desert. The inland ice has polished the rocks into a soft, rolling granite floor, into a solidified sand desert. It's not just a visual similarity. This environment places similar demands on species living here, with many sunshine hours and periodically strong heat. It means that the small rock pools are at great risk of drying out now and then. The weather is unpredictable and can suddenly change. Hard wind and salty water can sometimes wash over parts of the islands or all over. The archipelago of the Swedish west coast is young. It rose slowly from the sea when the pressure of the thick inland ice decreased less than 15,000 years ago, when the ice started to melt away. The inland ice has polished and shaped a soft rolling mountain landscape. The outer archipelago, largely consisting of bare rocks, has a very limited bush and tree vegetation. In spite of the harsh environment, species occur here that you may not expect. Warm evenings in May, you can hear a beautiful chorus from the small islets of the outer coastline. It is the croak of the natterjack toad, our smallest toad. Males try to attract females by blowing up their big vocal sac and sing in the night. With his powerful arm muscles, he hugs his female and tries to induce her to lay the eggs, which he then fertilizes outside her body. It's hard for a new male to take over a female who already has a courting cavalier, well ensconced on her back. If he tries to hug another male, he is brutally rejected with a clear creaking call. The northernmost distribution limit of the natterjack toad is here, in this harsh environment. One way to cope with the competition and attacks from predators may be the ability to endure a difficult environment. The natterjack toad has also developed a unique reproductive strategy. It uses small, shallow and temporary rock pools for its reproduction. Few predator insects occur here to eat its larvae, since the shallow pools regularly dry out. But the natterjack toad needs 6 to 7 weeks to complete the water-based development. There is a great risk that the water will dry out before the larvae have completed their development of becoming land-dwelling toadlets. Most amphibians on our latitudes, such as the common frog, have a different strategy. They reproduce as early as possible in spring. They often choose water without fish and with a shallow and warm shoreline that enables fast growth in eggs and larvae. The mating is intense, slightly chaotic, and is often over in a few days. The early mating period is a way to use as much as possible of the warm spring and summer period. The eggs need time to develop through different larval stages into metamorphosed small frogs, who must grow and store enough energy for the winter. The natterjack toad has developed its own unique strategy to cope with the risk of shallow rock pools drying out too soon. In one and the same population, some females lay eggs early and others late in the season. You can't know which females will be successful in their reproduction a single year, as the weather cannot be predicted. In the same population, there is always a mix of females with different strategies, those who lay eggs early and others who are late. This mixed reproductive strategy in the same population is unusual in an animal species. If the spring is hot and dry, the first wave of eggs and larvae will dry and be lost before they have developed into land-dwelling small toads. But after a new rain, the small rock pools fill up again, a new mating period starts. With a bit of luck, the ponds will now keep their water long enough for the next group of natterjack toads to complete their waterborne development and be metamorphosed small toads. Desert-like conditions are also found on the Baltic island of Öland. A unique environment, the Alvar, characterized by a thin plant layer on limestone bedrock, grinded plain by the glacial ice. The large, open, sun-exposed rock face contains shallow water pools that often dry out. The Alvar on Öland covers 350 square kilometers and is thus the world's largest grazed limestone area. Spring on the Alvar is often damp and green, followed by extreme drought during the summer. Plants and animals living here are well adapted to these conditions, and some, like the Öland rock rose, are endemic to Öland and found nowhere else. Here on the Alvar you can also find probably the toughest animals on Earth. Like mythical superheroes, they hide almost supernatural abilities behind their quiet exterior. The scientific name tardigrade suggests that they move slowly with their 8 clawed legs and bear-like chubby body. The mouth of some are transformed into sharp stilettos, which they extend to pierce their prey. In English, they are called water bears, and few people have seen them. Unprotected in space, you would lose consciousness because of oxygen deficiency. You would be burned by the UV light despite the cold space. Gamma and X-rays would destroy parts of your DNA. Unless you are a water bear, of course. In September 2007, the spacecraft Photon M3 took off from Kazakhstan with water bears on board. For 12 days, the water bears were exposed to extreme conditions with strong UV and cosmic radiation. After returning back home, they showed no signs of damage. And later, they bred and produced healthy offspring. Water bears are living dead. When the environment changes to the worse, they withdraw their 8 legs and look like a barrel. They shut down life and metabolism and go into a deep dormancy. When the surroundings become more beneficial again, they stick out their legs and resume life, which can be several decades later. Out here on Öland's Alvar, you can come across several water bears. We will meet the researcher Ingemar Jönsson, one of the world's leading experts in water bears.
I den här mosthuvan så finns det säkert björndjur. Och björndjuren har ju anpassat sig att leva i väldigt tuffa miljöer, framförallt väldigt torra miljöer och kalla miljöer. Och de klarar det därför att de kan förlora allt vatten i kroppen. De är fullständigt uttorkningståliga.
Water bears can withstand extreme stress. They can shut down life and lie dehydrated for decades, and then come back to life again with a drop of water. They can be frozen to minus 272 degrees Celsius and heated up to 150 degrees. They can withstand vacuum and a pressure 600 times higher than on land. They stand 1,000 times higher doses of radioactivity than humans. This has led to speculations that life on Earth may have come from space through water bears. But these are just speculations. The most interesting point for us humans may perhaps be the water bear's ability to prevent DNA damage and to repair the DNA. This knowledge can help us develop important drugs linked to the treatment of cancer and aging. We have named about 1.2 million species, ranging from the smallest creatures to more complex animals, plants and fungi. But there are many more. We know only 15 to 20% of the actual number of species on Earth. During millions of years, evolution has tested, developed, and refined new adaptations. The appearances, behaviors, and ways of life we see in different species today are the result of a long process where only the most efficient and the smartest solutions are left. In dry areas in different parts of the world, we can see many examples of plants and animals that, against all odds, have developed an ability to survive in a very tough world. These adaptations and behaviors have only developed and prevailed because they favored the plant's or animal's own survival. But in many cases, these species possess a knowledge that we can benefit from for our own survival. We have seen some examples of species that helped us develop important drugs and exciting new technologies and a more sustainable society. We can only guess which species conceal knowledge to solve the problems of tomorrow. The next episode shows examples of species that helped us develop the modern chainsaw, infrared technology, effective pain relief, and important drugs for stomach ulcers. Many of these species are found in the forest, in exotic parts of the world, but also nearby in our own forests.